Hi, I'm Kristin Dimac-Stohl, and welcome to the Duke Research Greenhouses. Today I'm going to be showing you amazing plants, and we're going to start with our carnivorous collection. These incredible plants grow up in an environment where they can't get to the nutrients in the soil because there aren't any. So basically they have evolved a better way of getting those nutrients, especially nitrogen, and that is by eating insects. So we have several different ways, different mechanisms that they eat the insects. Right here we have some plants using the sticky trap mechanism. So you can actually see we've got little tiny bugs stuck to all of these sticky plants. And basically once the bug gets stuck, the plant starts digesting it. And right next to these guys, we have the pitcher plants. And the pitcher plants are called a pitfall trap because they basically make it really inviting to come in. And once the bugs are fallen down into this tube, they can't get out. And they start to be digested by the plant's enzymes in the tube. And another one of the most famous mechanisms that plants use to eat bugs is shown by the Venus flytrap. Right here, we've got these famous clasping jaws that actually are a mechanism. Once three little tiny sensory hairs on the leaf are tripped by that bug, the leaf then closes down on it. And the reason is that there's a lot of energy that it takes for the plant to close the trap. And so the three hairs are important to let the plant know that the bug is big enough for the closing energy to be worth it. So these pitchers are actually a little bit bigger than some of the ones in North America. And basically the same mechanism as before. The bugs are gonna get attracted to this area. They're gonna start to go into the pitcher and they're gonna fall. And there's a sticky digestive solution in the bottom. So once they're down there, they start becoming the meal for the plant. We are now in the tropical zone of the Duke Live Collections. And these plants are acclimated to areas of the world that have excess rainfall and high temperatures. So because they don't have to fight a freeze every year, they grow very large and they have some special adaptations in order to wick away excess water from their leaves in order to prevent bacterial infection. So first off, we have a leaf that looks like it has slits. Some of the plants use small holes. These are ways that the more rainfall that falls, only part of it is actually staying on the leaf. A lot of the leaves also have pointed tips in a way to draw the water down and then leave the leaf. These leaves also have a waxy coating, and that is another way of protecting their leaves from water sitting on top. Another thing that these plants have to deal with is crowding, because tropical forests are so wonderfully built for plants, there's usually a lot of life and a lot of big plants. Because things get so crowded, a lot of the plants in the understory don't get enough light to grow. So some ways that they have adapted in order to survive is we see a lot of large leaves so that they can collect any little bit of sunlight that drips down into the bottom of the forest. They also have darker pigmented leaves so that the sunlight that does reach their leaf can actually be better utilized. And a few of the plants, much like this guy right here, end up just climbing up another plant in order to get higher and to reach more sunlight. We are now in the xeric portion of our collections. And xeric is a word that describes an environment with very little to almost no water. So the plants in this room have had it pretty tough and they've adapted in order to hold on to every little bit of water that they get. The first group of these plants, which are making a breakout into the market, are the succulents. And these plants save all their water in their leaves. That way they can access it later if they have an especially dry month or two. The most extreme example of this are a group of plants called the living stones. And these plants actually are holding water in their leaves. The large rock-like portions are actually their leaves. And they employ an even more extreme way to hold on to their water, and that's camouflage. So these guys actually in the desert are not what a predator or a herbivore would normally go toward. So they kind of sit by the side as they go along and hold on to all that water that they've been saving. Here we have the cacti, some of the most famous xeric plants, with their chubby stems and their spines. These plants have actually adapted probably the most to an extreme environment than any other plants. The cacti are actually from North America and South America, and we have an example of convergent evolution that is seen in this plant. This plant is actually from the euphorb family and is not related to cacti at all. It has evolved a lot of the same mechanisms to protect itself from the environment and from herbivory or predation, but if I were to pierce the skin of this euphorb right now, it would be milky and white that came out of that cut as opposed to water. And that's because these plants are full of latex. Another cool adaptation of these cacti that I can't forget to mention is a very fine, feathery white hair. And this actually acts in two forms. It protects the plant from the sun as sort of a sunscreen, and it also protects the plants from the harsh winds that sometimes are found in the desert. We're now in the temperate zone of the Duke Research Greenhouse's live collections. And this zone is one of the more temperate, more moderate climates that we have. So right now I'd like to show you a group of plants called the epiphytes. Now, epiphyte means that a plant can get all of its nutrients and all of its water just out of the air. So this frees up these plants to live in the crooks of other trees or in other areas high up in the canopy where they can get more sunlight. Our first example right here is Spanish moss. And if you've ever driven through the southeast of the United States, you'll see tons of this hanging over trees. It's actually its own plant and it sits on the trees to get its leverage, but it gets all that it needs out of the air. Another cool example are the tillandsias, which are actually being marketed more and more, known as the air plants that you see for your bathroom or for your kitchen. And these guys are the exact same. They sit on top of a tree, much like they are right here, and they get everything that they need out of the air. We have a group of plants called bromeliads. Something familiar from the bromeliad group is the pineapple, if you've ever had a pineapple. And these plants are incredible because they actually collect water, and that water serves as a tiny ecosystem for frogs and insects. And much like the carnivorous plants that benefit from an insect relationship, these guys actually benefit from the poop of the frogs and the insects. And that is how they get their nitrogen. And a conversation wouldn't be complete about epiphytes if we didn't talk about the most famous one, the orchid. We have quite a variety of orchids here at the greenhouse. Orchids show quite a variety of morphology, including the ones that are straight up in the trees and have aerial roots to get the nutrients and water that they need out of the environment, all the way down to this terrestrial orchid that I'm holding that actually grows right in the ground just like any other plant. This concludes our tour of the Duke Research Greenhouse's live plant collections. For every plant that we've seen today, there are 10 more that are incredible that you should come and see yourself. When COVID restrictions are lifted, we would love for everyone to schedule a tour using our greenhouse staff at duke.edu email. Thanks so much.